Hi, I'm Zor. Welcome to Unizor Education. Many times I was talking that the most important part of any course of mathematics is to solve problems. Well, let's solve problems today. The problems will be about derivatives and everything we know by now about derivatives. Just six problems where different aspects of whatever we have learned should be applied. Now, this lecture is part of the advanced course of mathematics presented on Unizor.com. I suggest you to watch this lecture from this website because every lecture actually has very detailed notes which can serve as a textbook basically. And also the signed in students can participate in the educational process, which involves enrollment. And for this you need your supervisor or a parent, and you can take exams as many times as you want just to gauge your success in learning the material. And the site is free, by the way. All right, so a few problems. The problem number one is, let's consider this function. So my statement is about behavior of this function when x goes to infinity. And basically I'm saying that e to the power of minus x, and you know the graph is something like this, goes to zero much faster than x to the power of n, which graphs like this, approximately. So this goes to infinity, and this goes to zero. And obviously, just looking at it, it's not obvious where their product actually would go. But here is what I suggest. Let's rewrite it as and use the L'Hopital's rule. Now, the L'Hopital's rule states that if you have this ratio of two functions, it behaves when x goes to some limit, including infinity, exactly the same way as the ratio of their derivatives. Now, let's think about derivatives. Well, the derivative of this would be, well, there's no equal sign. Derivative of numerator would be n x to the power of n and e to the power of x, right? This is, sorry, minus one. This is derivative of this, and e to the power of x is derivative of e to the power of x, as we know, right? So the limit of this as x goes to infinity is equal to the limit of this as x goes to infinity. But now we still have some kind of indeterminate limit, because this is infinity and this is infinity as x goes to infinity, right? Well, okay, but let's use the L'Hopital's rule again. The next would be n times n minus 1 x to the power of n minus 2. That's the derivative of numerator, and here we will still have the same. Okay, is it better? Well, not much, it's still infinity, right? But now, let's do this process n times. And what do we have in this case? Well, after n times, we will have n factorial, obviously, right? N times n minus 2, minus n minus 2, times n minus 3, etc. And x would be basically to the power of 0, which is 1. And in the denominator, we still have e to the power of x, because this is the nth derivative of this, right? And now this, n is a constant, right? Now this we know for sure goes to zero. So after implementing this, after using this L'Hopital's rule n times, we basically have reduced our problem of determining this limit to this, from this to this, and from this to this, and this is easy. And the result is zero, so that actually signifies that a to the power of minus x goes much faster to zero than x to any numeric power. I'm talking about, obviously, a natural number n, otherwise we would not have nice constant 1 at the very end. All right? So that's my first problem. So x to the power of n grows slower than e to the power of minus x diminishing. Now let's consider a different combinational function. Okay, so x to the power of n, we know, is growing not as fast as e to the power of x, or e to the power of minus x goes to zero faster than x to the power of n. Now, how about logarithm? Well, the logarithm is going to infinity slower than x to any power. And how can we prove it? Again, let's use the L'Hopital's rule. So the limit of this as x goes to infinity is equal to ratio of their derivatives. Derivative of logarithm x is 1x. Derivative of this is n power n x to the power n minus 1. And now it's obvious that if x goes to infinity, then this goes to 0, which proves that x to the power of n is growing faster than logarithm x, or if you wish, x to the power of minus n goes to 0 faster than logarithm n goes to infinity. So that's my second problem. So as far as speed of growing, logarithm is slower than a power function, and power is slower than exponential function. Okay. Next is about approximate calculation using differential instead of increment of the function. Let's just think about this. Now, given that natural logarithm of 10 is equal to 2.302585. Somebody gave me this number, all right? What I do want to calculate really is logarithm of 10.1. So remember how we were dealing with this? F of x plus delta x. Now this is 10 and this is 0.1. And f obviously is logarithm, right? Now, remember this, that this is delta f at x. Now, approximately, if delta x is really small, remember we were talking about that this is approximately or delta x, doesn't really matter. So this is something which we were talking about when we were discussing differential. So this is increment of the function, and we were talking that since if we divide it by delta x and delta x goes to zero, we will get a derivative, right? Remember this? F of x plus delta x minus f at x divided by delta x. If delta x goes to zero, it's equal to derivative at point x, right? So if x is relatively, delta x is relatively small, then we can say that, forget about this limit then, this is approximately plus some kind of infinitesimal variable, right? Now we go multiply by delta x and we will get this, and to be exact, this is plus epsilon delta x, right, from this. But epsilon is infinitesimal, and delta x is infinitesimal, while this is not an infinitesimal. So this is an infinitesimal of a higher order than this. And that's why we can do this approximation. So instead of equal, we can put approximately and get rid of this. Now, obviously, this needs to be some kind of justified, because delta x can go to zero, but question is how close to zero which is, etc. So it all depends, obviously. However, what I'm asking in this problem is, well, forget about all these nuances. Just consider that point one is as small enough. And if it's a small enough, how to use this formula for differential of the function? This is differential of the function, this is increment of the function. So replace increment of the function, so how much this grows relatively to this, replace it with differential of the function. Now, why is it better? Well, it's significantly better because this is very easy to find out. What is the derivative of logarithm? It's 1 over x. So I know that this is 1 over x, where x is equal to 10. Now this is 0.1. So I can actually very easy calculate my value as function of x, which is given, plus this piece. Plus, this is 1/10, right? 1 over x at x is equal to 10, times another 0.1, so it's 0.01. And the result is 2.312585. Okay? So that's approximate value of this. That's what our calculations show. Now, how good is it? Well, let me give you an exact number which I got from the calculator. So this is approximation. Now, exact value would be 2.312535. So we have this fifth digit after the decimal point wrong, which is not bad. So up to four digits after decimal, we are okay. All right. Well, now you can ask, why should I actually do all these mathematical manipulations if I can just go to a calculator and get this number? Well, it has educational purposes, all right? Just to show that you can use differential as an approximation to increment of the function. So the problem is not practical. Problem is educational, all right? So let's just settle on that. Next problem, also educational. I would like to make this more precise. And for this, I would like to use the Taylor series. Do you remember the Taylor series? We can actually represent So this is Taylor series. So if you don't remember it, just go to the corresponding lecture where I explain what actually this is all about and how to derive this, basically. So my point is the following. Now, this is a series, which means it's converging. which means we can cut some kind of a tail and we will get an approximate value of this thing, right? So what I'm asking in the next problem is cut this tail. So leave only up to second derivative. And do exactly the same problem. Calculate approximately what exactly the result would be if I'm using this, where x0 is obviously 10, and x is obviously 10.1. x minus x0 is obviously 0.1. And now you can calculate it. Now the first derivative, now this is logarithm of 10, which is given, right? So it's 2.302585. Now this is exactly what we had the first time, right? The derivative, which is 0.1, because it's 1 over 10. 1 over x is derivative of logarithm, and x is equal to 10, right? So it's 1 tenth. And this is also difference between these two, so it's also 1 tenth. So it's times plus 1/100, right? So 0.01. Okay, second derivative, it's from 1 over x, it's minus 1 over x squared, right? So minus 1 over x squared, x is equal to 10, so it's minus 0.01 times, this is also 1 tenth square 1 hundredths divided by 2, so it's 0.005, right? So we subtract, multiplication. This is from the derivative, and this is from this member, right? And if I multiply, it would be minus 0.00005, right? 2 0, and then I have to move it to the right by 2 positions. So that's what will be. All right, so it's minus 0.12345. Okay, let's see what happens. Well, it's 2.302. No, it's 312. If I add this one, 585. Minus 0.000050. So it's 535213.2. And this is, by the way, equals to whatever I got on calculator. So up to 6 positions after the decimal point, my calculations just based on 2 members of the tail or series is already corresponds to the calculator, right? So one position gives me 4 digits after decimal point correctly. 2 members of the tail or series give me 6, right? Now without this one, that's the previous problem basically. And with the second derivative, that gives me even more precision. All right, that was my other problem. Let's go on. So we had a problem related to L'Hopital's rule. We had the problem related to differential and Taylor series. And now we will talk about differential along the curve. So I have 2 problems about this. My first curve is a circle. And let's imagine that we have a particle which moves on this circle of radius r. So it moves on this circle, and this is how it moves. I basically give the angle as a function of time. So as the time goes, whatever this function is, well, it's obviously in radians, that's how it goes, all right? That's if it's increasing. Well, it might actually increase, it might decrease, it's a function, right? So a function can go anywhere it wants. It has its own mind on its own, right? So, and the particle along this circle goes according to this particular function. My question is, what is its absolute speed as it goes along this curve, and what are the components of this speed, which are projections of the vector of velocity of this particular particle on x and y axis. Okay, so first of all, we have to find out what are the coordinates of our curve, and that gives us the movement as the function of time, right? So x coordinate of the point is equal to r times cosine of the angle, and angle is a function of time, so angle is changing, it's a function of time, and that's why my x coordinate is, and y coordinate, it's obviously sine of this. Now, if we are talking about the speed, remember what speed actually is? Well, you have to take a small piece of the curve, of the length of the curve, differential along the along this curve, and divide by the time. Now, obviously, this is function of t, right? And you remember that actually it's equal to this. It's a very easy thing to derive this formula. It was derived basically when I was talking about differential along the curve. So this is the absolute speed of our particle as it moves along this circle. Okay, so let's find it out. Equals to, this is equal to r square. Now the derivative of the x is r minus sine of phi of t, sine of phi of t, and derivative of the t, and I didn't put the minus sign because I'm still raising it to the power of 2, so it's square, so it doesn't matter minus or plus here, right? Now, similarly here, r square cosine square of 5t times derivative of the phi square. And this is all under the square root. And obviously it is equal to r square and derivative of the phi square can be factored out. I will have sine square plus cosine square, which is 1, and the square root would be r and absolute value of derivative of the phi. So that's my absolute speed of this particle. So if I have the function angle as a function of time, then absolute speed as it goes along the circle, any direction, any way, that would be my absolute speed. Now, whenever we are talking about velocity, we are talking about a vector which has certain direction and this length. And direction and length obviously are very much related to individual components. The projection of this vector of velocity on the x-axis and the axis and the y-axis, and these projections are obviously here. So x derivative of x of t, that would be my component along the x-axis, which is equal to minus r sine 5 t phi of t, and the y component of my velocity is derivative of the y coordinate, and it's r cosine here t. So these are my two components. Now, is there anything else which I'm missing? So again, this would be equal to r and absolute value of the derivative. This absolute value of the derivative of the phi of the angle, it's called angular speed, by the way. So if you have a function which represents angle as a function of the time, derivative of this angle as a function of the time is angular speed. It's exactly similar to if you have a function which is distance as a function of time, then derivative of the distance is the speed. Now, obviously, it's different at different moments in time. As the t goes, phi is changing, and the speed, which is derivative of the phi at point t, also might not be exactly the same. However, if my angle is proportional to time, which means my movement actually is going without changing of the speed, then the derivative would be equal to c, right? Always, regardless of the time, it would be constant angular speed. So that's when we're talking about the movement of the particle without changing of the angular speed. So that's it, right? So that's my basically the problem where I wanted to talk about the differential along the curve, this ds of t. And the next problem, also related to curve and differential along this curve, now we are talking about a projectile which we are launching at certain angle to horizon. It has certain velocity, which has absolute value and angle. All right? So what's given is an angle and initial absolute value of the speed we are launching our projectile. And we basically have to do exactly the same in the previous problem. Find out vertical and horizontal components and absolute speed at any moment t. Well, let's first restrict our movement up to the top point when our projectile is rising. Now, it's rising, obviously, but the gravity pulls it down. Now, we know that there is a constant g, which is equal to 9.8 meters per second square, which is by how much per second my speed would be decreasing if you go up or increasing if you go down, right? My initial speed, v, has both horizontal and vertical components, right? So we can always represent this velocity as sum of two vectors. V is equal to Vx plus Vy. Right? That's the rule of parallelogram. Now, it's much easier to approach this problem from this perspective because we know for sure that Vx, the x component, doesn't really change with the time because there is no force which is horizontally acting. Well, we obviously assume there is no air resistance or something like this. However, vertical component is affected by the gravity. So if my initial value of the vertical component is V times sine phi, V is a constant and phi is a constant. These are initial values. So that's my initial value of the Vx. So it's a Vy, sorry. It's Vy at moment zero. Now, as the time goes by, every unit of time, we are changing our speed by g. We are reducing speed by g because the gravity pulls it down. So it's slowing down. And how much time actually it will do up until the point when my speed, vertical speed, will reach zero, right? That's the total time. That's the time of rising. But anytime the speed would be equal to initial speed minus constant g times t, because every unit of time we are reducing by g. So t units of time, we're reducing by g times t. So that will be my law of motion, if you wish, or dependency of the vertical component of the time. So we have actually determined the vertical component and horizontal component. Now, as you see, my horizontal component does not change. It's the same always because there are no forces which are help or restrict its movement. It just goes with this horizontal speed from the moment zero to any moment time, and it's equal to whatever it was initially, which is V times cosine of angle phi, right? So that's actually our two components of the speed at any time up to the moment when it reaches the top. So what, by the way, is the time when it reaches the top? That's when these two are equal to each other and the Vy is equal to zero. So the time to the top is equal to V sine phi divided by gt. V sine phi divided by gt, right? To make it equal to zero. So that's the time to the top. Now, up until this time, this is the law my vertical speed is changing, and this is the law my horizontal speed is changing. And what's my absolute speed is? Well, again, the absolute speed square root of Vx square plus Vy square, and it's equal to, okay, it would be square root of V square cosine square phi plus V sine phi minus gt square under the square root. So this is a function which describes my absolute speed. Now these are two functions which describe components of the velocity of the vector, which is here. Now, just out of some kind of, I always like to be sure that the formula is correct or something like this. So there is some checking which I would like actually to implement here. Let's think about it. At the very moment when it reaches the top, again, my horizontal speed is still the same, right, as it was before, which is v cosine phi. Now my vertical speed is zero, which means my total absolute speed should be the same as horizontal speed. So if I will substitute this moment t into this formula for absolute speed, I must have the result equal to v cosine phi, right? Well, let's just check it out. Always try to analyze if you have reasonable result, all right? So let's substitute, instead of t, we will substitute this particular my fault, by t here. If this is equal, then t is resolved as v sine phi divided by g. All right, so what do I have? I have v square cosine square phi plus v square sine square phi minus 2v sine phi gt plus gt square, and this is square. Now, if instead of t I substitute this, I will get here v square sine square phi divided by g square, right? Now, instead of this, v sine phi divided by g, right? So, obviously, g and g, g square, g square. This is v square and sine square, and this is v square and sine square. This is minus 2, this is 1. And this is together would be v square cosine square phi plus v square sine square phi minus 2v square sine square phi plus v square sine square phi. And this is all under the root, and this is canceling out, and as a result I have v cosine phi, as we should. So at the top point my formula gives exactly what we expect it to give. All right, so this is just the second problem about the movement along the curve, differential, the speed and stuff like this. Okay, I do suggest you to read all the notes for this lecture on unizor.com. Other than that, that's it. Thank you very much and good luck.